loveth thee. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Acts. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication.
Because your eyes call upon him,
the cords of death entangled me.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring word of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now on that same day, two of the disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And Jesus said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" And they stood still, looking sad. And then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days? And he asked them, what things? And they replied, the things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then Jesus said to them, oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us? That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, the Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road and how Jesus had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I know that the leftovers from Easter dinner 2 Sundays ago are finished. And the kids have eaten all the Easter candy with your assistance. But as far as the church is concerned, we are still on day one. This may be the third Sunday of Easter, but the story we are hearing in the gospel is only the beginning. Jesus Christ is risen today. To grasp this, you should put yourselves in the sandals of the disciples and the rest of Jesus' immediate circle. One day he is paraded into Jerusalem on a colt, heralded as a great teacher, a healer, possibly even more than that. A few days after that, he is arrested by the Roman army and taken to the provincial governor. The religious authorities, whom Jesus had really and truly cheesed off with his words and actions, demanded that he be put to death, ostensibly because he was a threat to Rome, but really because they saw him as a heretic. The spineless governor acquiesced. The soldiers did the bidding of the religious leaders, and they executed this itinerant rabbi, Jesus of Nazareth, less than a week after his rock star arrival in Jerusalem. From the heights of anticipation to the depths of despair, in a matter of hours. It wasn't that the rug had been pulled out from under his followers. The whole floor, the structure of their beliefs, had been eliminated. All the hopes and possibilities that Jesus had offered his listeners had been swept away. Everything he taught about a new way of believing in God was demolished. whatever he had said to people about living a new way of life must have been a lie. Or so everyone thought. One thing that Jesus said, and on more than one occasion, was that as part of God's plan to bring humanity back to his side, the Son of Man must suffer for others and die for their sins and rise from death on the third day. When God had his way, human death would not be the end. And so it was. Jesus the Christ was returned to life by God on the third day after his execution. And what a day that was. It started with Mary Magdalene and a few other women looking for the body of Jesus. But it was not there in the tomb where it had been left. Depending on the gospel account, either some angels or the revived Jesus, as we can see in the window there, met the women and reminded them that his teachings were true. Death no longer was the final destination for humans. There was life after death in God's dominion. The women were ordered to spread the word to the rest of the inner circle, which they did. Then around midday, Jesus appeared to most of the disciples who were hiding in the room which they had rented for the Passover just a few days before. He was no apparition. He was real. And that meant that everything he preached and taught was also real. But it was still a scary moment for Jesus' followers. The religious authorities were on the lookout for the remnants of this heretics gang, so they could put down this aberration once and for all. So after Jesus was killed, some of the disciples hid in Jerusalem. Others fled the city. But our Lord was not finished with presenting the good news in person. As you heard in the gospel this morning, two disciples had run away from Jerusalem in the aftermath of the crucifixion. They were headed to Emmaus, about 2 hours' walk from the city walls, and presumably a safer place to be. On such a dusty road, any traveler approaching from either direction would have been noticed well in advance. But Jesus apparently came out of nowhere. He joined Cleopas and the other unnamed follower and asked them about the deep discussion they were having. The three fell into conversation about the execution and resurrection of Jesus until they got to the town, where they rented a room at the inn and ordered a meal. It was there that Jesus broke and blessed the bread, and it all came together for the two escapees. The instruction, the attraction, the hope, the renewed possibilities. And when they understood what had happened, Jesus left as he had arrived, immediately and before their very eyes. The two disciples talked about this amazing reappearance of their Lord and teacher and decided to return to Jerusalem immediately to tell the others. We may think nothing of that, but it's really important. The meal they just ate with the risen Christ was at the end of the day. The sun had set and the roads were empty because everyone except soldiers feared being attacked and robbed by hooligans who preyed on the weak under the cover of darkness. No one went about at night. Yet these two were so excited by their encounter with the risen Christ that they were driven to leave the inn and spend the next 2 hours in the dark, disregarding their own safety, to head back home and spread the good news. Jesus Christ is risen today. It takes 3 whole Sundays to tell the tale of that first day of his return to life. Imagine the astonishment of the disciples when they met him in the morning at the tomb. In the middle of the day in the upper room at the inn where they had the first Eucharist, and at the end of the day in Emmaus. That which was lost was found. He who was dead was alive, as he had promised. It boggles the mind of us today. Imagine what it was like for those first Christians to have been face to face with this revelation of the power of the Almighty. Our God does the unexpected. He becomes human like us to know our hearts more completely. He dies like us so that he can plow through that last wall and open a way to eternal life with himself. He shows up when least expected to prove that he does exist way beyond the limitations of our minds. Those possibilities beyond our imaginations are part of the story from the Acts of the Apostles that we also heard this morning. To recount that, Jesus remained with his followers for 40 days after his resurrection, doing more teaching, healing, and other astounding things. And then he returned to heaven. And 10 days after that, the Holy Spirit came upon his followers, who were still using the room they had rented for the Passover several weeks before. The arrival of the Spirit made such a noise that all the neighbors came to see what was going on, 3,000 of them. Think about what a commotion you would have to create at your house to get 3,000 of your neighbors to come running. Mm-hmm. It was not just the numbers, however. It was also the understanding. Peter was given to preach as he had never preached before. Those who came to investigate heard from Peter's colleagues languages that spanned almost the known world, from what is now eastern Iran to Rome and into parts of northern Africa. There was nothing preached that day about the power of God that could not be understood by anyone present. Comprehension was automatic and total, and it spread from there. That was an amazing time. Jesus went from a village on the shore of the Sea of Galilee to the great city of Jerusalem. From a few fishermen to crowds of hundreds, if not thousands, of listeners and followers and believers. Every step of the way teaching about how God loves his creation so much, and that those who believe are called to live their lives with that same kind of love. From the impromptu parade into the city, to the betrayal, quickie trial, and immediate execution, and to the rising to life again as he prophesied, these were no ordinary events. They call attention to a God who does amazing things. We who have heard about these long past events every year since childhood are perhaps not as excited about the true meaning of Easter as we should be. Jesus Christ may be risen today, but who ate the last Cadbury egg after all? We aren't as amazed as we ought to be. The story of that first day, when Jesus Christ, the Son of God, kicked open the doors of oblivion and created a new path to God's side, is one that should not be forgotten. It is such an important story for our futures that the church dedicates 3 weeks to the retelling of that one special day. And how should we respond? By taking it into our hearts, by giving thanks to God for causing that day to happen and the story to be told, and by living our lives knowing that God loves us that much to make it all happen. Amen. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy, catholic, and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people for the third Sunday of Easter. The response to each collect is, glory and praise to you, O living God. In the flesh of the risen Christ, the invisible God walks with us. Let us pray to God for our needs and the needs of all peoples.
For the holy churches in every place, all the holy people of God, and for the unity of all, for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Chip, our bishop, Sally, our bishop-elect, and all bishops, in the Anglican cycle of prayer, for the church in the province of Uganda, in the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray St. George's Church in Pensfield and Rumson, Grace Church in Haddonfield, Merchantville, Pemberton, and Plainfield, and Grace St. Paul's Church in Mercerville, for Ron, our priest, Keith, our deacon, Mark, our organist choir master, and the ministry of our guest preachers, for all presbyters, deacons, seminarians, religious, and ministers in Christ, for this holy assembly present and watching, and all who gather for the breaking of the bread.
Glory and praise to you, O living God.
For the world and its leaders, for our brothers and sisters living in troubled places, especially Mississippi, Arkansas, California, and the Southwest, Haiti, Cuba, Mexico, Venezuela, Ukraine, Iraq, Iran, Lebanon, Turkey and Syria, Israel, Gaza and the West Bank, Malawi, Nigeria, Ethiopia, Yemen, Somalia, Sudan and South Sudan, Afghanistan, Myanmar, North Korea and South Korea, and for peace in all places.
Glory and praise to you, O living God.
For our nation, for those in positions of public trust, especially Joseph, our president, Philip, our governor, Dennis, the mayor of this community, and for all our communities, for police officers, firefighters, first responders, and those who guard the peace, that they will do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God.
Glory and praise to you, O living God.
For the sick and the suffering, especially Randy and Claire Rokiski, Lee Henderson, Marsha Bauer, Ray McManus, Linda, Judy Marine, Jim Agins, Landon, Jennifer Agins, Anne, David, Brian, Frank, Jessica Smith McGowan, Rick Holland, Joyce, David, Carl, Kava, Nicholas, Pam McKenzie, Aiden, Estelle, Donald, Michael, Kelly, Leslie, Kayla Gorman, Julie, Shirley Saunders, Michael and Joanne Polito, Delia, Zane, Ann Keffer, Cornelia Cummings, Libby Dodge Smith, Lois and Janet, Linda Olson, Lawrence Cowart, and for all those in danger in need, and those who are oppressed.
Glory and praise to you, O living God.
For the people of this parish, for those celebrating birthdays this week, Richard Ellis, Carly Moore, Evan Jacino, Caitlin Chatton, Lee and Tom Wolverton, Christopher Frost Jr., Mark Ellis, Cole Kansi Sao, Brandon Leonidas, John Hamer, Nicholas Britannic, Charles Agins, and Robert Strano. For all who celebrate wedding anniversaries, James and Wisleen Edwards, and Christopher and Samantha Vinay. For those we remember with gifts at the altar, especially the deceased members of the Paul and Marika Foreman families, and the Reverend Charles Fisk, 10th rector of St. John's Church. For those connected to our parish family who are serving in our armed forces, Nicholas Lofton, James Cerici, Brandon Akins, Jordan Greenup, Bertie Ferguson, Trey Robinson, Raymond Campos, Ryan Finelli, Jerry Perez, Bob Scott, and David Jones. For ourselves, our families, friends, and companions, and all those we love,
glory and praise to you, O living God.
For an end to racism and the too frequent turn to firearms to settle differences, and for our deliverance from all affliction, strife, and need,
glory and praise to you, O living God.
For the dying and the dead, especially Carson Kendall, James Edward Holmes, Gretchen Long, Michael LaCosta, and for those who remember them in the hope of the resurrection.
Glory and praise to you, O living God.
Remembering the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Francis, Blessed Zita of Tuscany, protector of domestic staff, Blessed John the Evangelist, our patron, and all the saints, let us offer ourselves and one another to the living God through Christ.
To you, O Lord our God. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, who opens our minds and hearts through the risen Christ. Hear our prayers which we offer in the hope of glory, and breathe upon us with your Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace. Peace, choir. Peace, Mark. Happy Easter. It's wonderful to see you. As the disciples came to know the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread, It heartens me and inspires me to know that you too have come to know the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread and in many other ways. And by extension, please know that it equally inspires and informs me to know that people who live in the community have come to know the risen Lord and many of the ministries are offered at St. John's Church. It heartens me to know that last Saturday, the Clothes Closet had a grand success in terms of its faithful ministry, not only in bringing in some money for St. John's Church, but community outreach. Those who hearkened the doors of our church received a glimpse of what God's kingdom is all about. And Laundry Love continues with its ministry, reaching people's hearts and minds. And certainly the Meals to Go is yet another ministry that St. John's Church is involved with that makes a difference. So thank you for your love and your compassion, your faithful commitment to make these ministries unfold. Last Saturday, a week ago yesterday, a man who lives in the community tied two dogs to the back door of the rectory. And on one hand, very sad to know that a family was breaking up and the mother and two sons had to relocate to another town. And the father and the two dogs were displaced, had nowhere to go. Where did they turn? St. John's Church. It heartens and inspires me to know that there are people who live in our community who trust us. And that's a bold thing, isn't it? To know that people look up to us and count on us. That kind of ministry is so critically important. The detective took a picture of the note that the man left. You know, dear Father Ron, please know that our family is relocating and I've known you 100 years. Didn't say that, but it was close to it. Thank you for being able to find a secure home for my two dogs. So with the help of some parishioners and Deacon Keith, we will be able to get the two dogs and bring them to a safe place. That heartens and inspires me. Today, we have visitors from the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Somerset Hills and some of their youth group members. Welcome to St. John's Church. Yay, we're thrilled that you're here. After the service, go through these doors, follow your nose to some coffee and some goodies, and then we'll meet in the far end of the parish hall. And I have some things I want to share with you about St. John's Church and about the Episcopal Church in general, and find other ways to welcome you into the life of our church. We're happy that you're here. Welcome again. Are there other particular announcements that need to be made? If you so desire, when you leave church, right outside of the carriage entranceway door, there are a number of pots of tulips that used to be in the windows. You might consider A, bringing them home and planting them and then enjoying them next spring, or plant them in our own garden out front so that the people of St. John's and the community in Somerville could enjoy them. And likewise, the Easter lilies, you are welcome to take some of them home as well. I enjoyed very quickly my retreat. Thank you for that time away. I am indeed grateful. It's important that there's time of respite and reflection and time for me to set aside, particularly thinking about you. Must be a sign. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings and come into his courts. As the congregation is able, please stand. Remember with me, please, that all baptized Christians are welcome to receive communion. This is not an Episcopal table. Indeed, this is the Lord's table. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, O Father, almighty creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him ye have delivered us from evil, made us worthy to stand before you. In him ye have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Mary, Joseph, Francis, John, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
As the congregation is able, please stand. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect to do his will, that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.